You know, with the way this film's revered, you can even say it's treated like royalty. What's going on, everyone? Welcome back to my channel and a brand new review series. Actually, my second review series going on at the moment, as I'm also doing The Addams Family right now. But No Time to Die is finally coming to us after so many delays, and truthfully, I was starting to think it was never gonna come out. But it's Daniel Craig's last James Bond movie, so of course, I'm going to revisit and review all of his Bond films, which will then be followed by a ranking of all five movies. And we're starting off with one of the most critically acclaimed James Bond movies of all time, Casino Royale. Let me know before we begin what your thoughts on Casino Royale were in the comments below, as well as make sure to hit that thumbs up button if you like these reviews, as it helps me out immensely by getting my channel out there. And if you're new here, I hope you consider hitting that subscribe button so you can stay up to date with more movie-related content like reviews and rankings on a near daily basis. But let's jump right into it, and let's talk about Casino Royale. After earning 00 status and a license to kill, secret agent James Bond, played of course by Daniel Craig, sets out on his first mission as 007. Bond must defeat a private banker funding terrorists in a high-stakes game of poker at Casino Royale, Montenegro. So before we begin, as I do with most of my reviews on older films, this will get into some spoiler territory. So if you haven't seen Casino Royale and you wish to know nothing, this is your spoiler warning. Go watch the movie and then come back to this. But anyway, here we go. This is directed by Martin Campbell, and it's actually the first Bond film since 1987's The Living Daylights to be based off an Ian Fleming novel, as Timothy Dalton's second film, License to Kill, as well as all of Pierce Brosnan's films, were original stories. And unlike all the other Bond films, which were more like soft reboots whenever a new actor stepped in, preserving some of the same elements and were still loosely in the same continuity, this is a total reboot of the character, showing a younger and less experienced Bond, with the only holdover from the Brosnan films being Judi Dench as M. And it's fitting they use this to reboot the franchise, considering Casino Royale was the very first Bond novel Ian Fleming wrote. Now, I'd like to make it clear that I'm not exactly a diehard James Bond fan. Now, I've seen all the movies, I love just about all the Sean Connery films, but then everything from there is pretty hit and miss for me, with only a few others being close to on the same level as those early films. And it's partially due to the quality of some of the films themselves, and partially because spy movies are one of those subgenres I'm not always keen on. Now, I like them enough, but they need to really do something special in order for me to love them. And I'd say that was without a doubt the case here. I will be upfront and say not only is this one of the best ways for new fans to be introduced to Bond, but this is one of the best Bond films, period. Tonally, this marks something of a departure from what we're used to with Bond. While there have been attempts at making him a little more serious with Timothy Dalton and Pierce Brosnan, there was still an emphasis on silly gadgets and snappy one-liners, and there wasn't quite as much focus on emotion. This, on the other hand, is a much more serious, deeply emotional Bond film, and probably one of his most tragic tales. This fit into a trend that I've talked about last year in my video on Batman Begins, where after that film came out, so many other movies at the time attempted to be these franchise reboots of popular characters and attempted to go for grittier reinterpretations of what are usually lighthearted stories. It's something we'll still see here and there today, but it was huge in the mid to late 2000s. And while this was only released a year after Batman Begins, and it was in production around the same time as that, so there was probably less influence from it directly, it does technically fall into that trend that it kicked off. And that trend is something I've never been exactly a huge fan of to this day, as I think some films tend to be dark and gritty without much substance to back them up. But this is a film where it works, and to be fair, it was also welcome, as it was the first time in such a long time where the Bond characters felt really human. This is a more flawed Bond who's prone to make some mistakes on the job as he figures himself out, and while there's still that wit and cunning edge to him, not every decision he makes might be the best. And what's also nice too is how much emphasis is placed on the romance side of things, just as much as there's an emphasis on the action, where you have a character who's written just as strongly as Bond himself. Here you have Eva Green as Vesper Lynd, who's easily one of the best Bond girls out there, if not the absolute best. While this is a James Bond movie first and foremost, Lynd is equally as complex as he is, having moments where she's dealing with her own internal struggles that Bond attempts to help her with, which causes their worlds to become entangled, and you find yourself totally wrapped up in their romance, especially as Craig and Green have such fantastic chemistry with one another, which makes it all the more heartbreaking when we get to her betrayal and death in the last act, which leaves such a sting after an already action-packed 2 hours. And I want to make it clear that, despite the fact that this might be considered the gritty reboot of James Bond, unlike other films in this trend that I was just talking about, this was never just depressing and dark for the sake of it. This isn't a 2.5 hour sulk fest. It still knew how to evoke other emotions from us, which is something that I feel is totally lost on a lot of other films that try to copy movies like this or the Dark Knight trilogy. I mean, even though it's not as corny or silly as the previous Bond films, it's still actually kind of funny at times. There are still some nice one-liners that they throw in there that caught some of the tension, usually uttered by Bond himself. And this shows us that just because someone's a tragic figure, it doesn't mean we can't see multiple sides of them, and I appreciate that. And I think this did a nice job of getting in some subtle quips without reverting back to the campiness they were trying to get away from. But let's talk about Daniel Craig himself as Bond. He is fantastic, and a man with such great screen presence, which has always been the case for him. You feel the weight of each moment every time he's on screen, and here he makes Bond feel really cool. Not that the other Bonds didn't accomplish that, or at least try to accomplish that, but Craig takes it to a whole other level here. Now, I never saw this movie at the time of its release. It wasn't until a few years later when I caught it, so I didn't realize there was such a huge controversy over Craig being cast as Bond, mainly due to him not fitting a certain image defined by Ian Fleming's novels. And this is something we see to this day with casting choices. If someone doesn't look like a spitting image of the actor previously portraying a character, or if they don't look exactly like how they were drawn, it's considered no good to many people. But I mean, with fictional characters, especially ones who originated in written form, there's gotta be some room for interpretation. I think it's ridiculous when people lose their minds over someone not having a specific look of a fictional character. Now, while there have been some actors who took on iconic roles and wound up confirming people's fears about them, I'd rather we wait and actually see them in action before passing judgment over their performance, because there have been plenty that have taken us by surprise. And in this case, I'm glad it all worked out and Craig basically got to prove everyone wrong, as he was phenomenal here, as he is in pretty much all the Bond films. But this shows how he's on par with, if not possibly better than Sean Connery, who was easily the best of all the Bond actors before Craig. I'm not going to say for sure just yet he's the better of the two, as I do need to go back and rewatch all the Connery movies, but it is close. But not only are Craig and Green fantastic here, but so is Mads Mikkelsen as the villain, the Schiff. I've said this in a number of other videos before, but Mads Mikkelsen is someone who is just electrifying each time he's on screen. Even when he's been in a bad movie, he's someone who gives it his all, and he once again is just excellent here, quite possibly one of the best Bond villains of all time. He's someone who doesn't need to say much, and you feel just how much he's a force to be reckoned with as if he was talking. Everything from his body movements to his delivery to the way he hangs onto each word when he talks, he exudes this really grand presence that you just can't get enough of, even though you're supposed to hate the guy. While there are several films that prove just how great of an actor he is, this is most certainly up there as one of them. And I was impressed with the way his storyline weaves into the overall plot, because for much of the film, the conflict mainly just comes down to between him and Bond, though this manages to subvert some expectations a bit in the way a lot of that conflict's resolved, because in a rare move, especially for a Bond film, Le Chiffre isn't in the movie all the way through. He gets killed and we still have like another half hour or so of the movie to go, which is something you don't often see, especially in a big mainstream film like this. But with that, this leads to the first signs that Bond's world is opening up, and we start seeing things like these grander conspiracies, which then gets into Vesper Lynd's betrayal, the organization behind Le Chiffre getting involved, as well as the storyline that leads into the next film, Quantum of Solace. And I gotta say, I was impressed with the way this film just pulled the rug right out from under us, thinking that we were gonna get Le Chiffre in the film all the way to the end. I mean, I'm a little upset, as you can never get enough of Mads Mikkelsen, but I liked how it still managed to keep things really intriguing, despite killing off the main villain a lot earlier than expected. Now, I also can't forget Martin Campbell's direction here. Now, admittedly, I haven't seen all this film, films, but I do think he's someone who doesn't get quite enough credit as a director, especially as an action director, because the way he shoots each of these sequences, there's a level of sophistication to them from the shot compositions that you really feel the tension each and every frame. The action scenes are slick, with the chase sequences in particular being exhilarating. There's one at the beginning that's done really well, plus there's an airport scene that's just fantastic. Though while those two are the ones that stuck out the most to me, they're all great, and they even have a little bit of that subtle humor that I mentioned earlier. Like in the chase from the very beginning of the film, there's a guy that Bond is chasing that does all these elaborate moves to jump out a window so he can avoid being captured, and Bond follows him down the same path but just runs right through a wall in order to keep up with him, and I got a nice little chuckle out of that. I love little moments that they added in there like that. But even moments like dialogue-driven sequences are just really well done here, such as whenever Bond speaks with M. While they have this relationship where she's chastising him for being some sort of rogue agent who really needs to play by the rules more, you're still mesmerized by these moments thanks both to Campbell's direction as well as Judi Dench's top-notch performance here, which makes these scenes feel fresh despite playing into tropes we've seen so many times before. And even the poker scene is just as hypnotic. Like, I'm not even a poker fan, but I found myself entranced by this scene, partially because it's one of the most crucial scenes in the entire movie, but also due to the way that Campbell gives it this claustrophobic feel to really bring out how high the stakes were, and it was awesome. It reminded me in some ways of the brilliance of The Sting from the 1970s, which was an entire movie that was very action-driven, but rarely had an actual fight, as it instead drew out its tension from things like card games and bets on horse races. Now, while these are ultimately two totally different movies, the fact that I felt so much tension from a poker game just gave me very similar vibes to that classic film, and I appreciate that. And I also can't forget one of the most iconic elements in a James Bond movie, which is the opening song. This one is You Know My Name by the late, great Chris Cornell, and I feel like, despite the fact it received critical acclaim at the time, it is such an overlooked song. Like, I never hear it brought up as one of the best Bond songs, and I guess it's fitting that this wound up being unfortunately snubbed at the Oscars for Best Original Song, but Cornell's vocals are haunting here, and it really set the tone for what we're in for with this film, how it's going to be a much different Bond movie than what we're used to. I always enjoyed it back when I first saw the movie, and upon hearing it again for this review, it's now caused me to go back quite a number of times to listening to it, and I can't get enough of it. Now, when it comes to my criticisms, I really don't have too many, to be quite honest. It's mainly just nitpicks and things that come down to personal preference. I'd say, with it being nearly 2.5 hours, they could have maybe shaved off a minute or two here and there, as I did feel the length just a touch at times. Though it also could be due to just my feelings of spy movies in general. Like I said, this isn't exactly one of my favorite subgenres of films. Now, I did just get through saying there's much more of an emotional attachment here than your average Bond film, or even your average spy movie for that matter, but with any of these sort of films, there's always a lot of name dropping and people and places being referenced, and maybe in a handful of those really dialogue driven moments, maybe I didn't quite feel as emotionally attached for a little bit, but I think it's really just going to come down to personal preference here. That might be something that won't bother anyone at all. I know these films obviously have their fan bases, and for those audience members, that might not be much of an issue, so it could just be a me thing, but otherwise, there's really not much to criticize here. Casino Royale is, simply put, one of the best James Bond movies out there. It serves as an excellent reimagining of the character, who's brought to life incredibly well by Daniel Craig, who's in top-notch form here, as are Ava Green and Mads Mikkelsen. It's a film that gave us a gritty reboot of the character, but thanks to Martin Campbell's direction, it also knew how to evoke other emotions from us, being just as exciting as it is dark, and even managing to be a little humorous at times as well, without being campy like other Bond films. It serves as a great introduction to the character, so if you've yet to see any of the James Bond films before, this is a perfect place to start. Casino Royale gets a 9.5 out of 10. So stay tuned, next week will be my review of the second Daniel Craig Bond movie, Quantum of Solace. But in the meantime, let me know, did you see Casino Royale, or are you planning to see it, and what were your thoughts? Is this your favorite Daniel Craig Bond movie? Is this one of your favorite Bond movies of all time? Let me know in the comments below so we can discuss. Also, if you enjoyed this video, please like it, and share it, and for more movie reviews and film discussion, please make sure to hit that subscribe button to stay updated. Thanks for watching, everyone, and keep having fun with film.